Good evening, everyone. I'd like to call this meeting of the San Benito Consolidated Independent School District Board of Trustees regular board meeting of Tuesday, February 10th at 7 p.m. Please state aye when I call your name for the roll call. Hector Leal.
Aye.
Oscar Medrano.
Aye.
Angel Mendez.
Aye.
Ana Cruz.
Aye.
Fatima Huerta.
Aye.
Ileana Gonzalez.
Aye.
Dr. Mark Puig.
Aye.
And our attorney, Mr. Torres. We do have a quorum. Next item on the agenda is item number three, Pledge Allegiance. I think we have some young ladies to recognize.
Leading us in the Pledge of Allegiance is Lauren Vargas. Lauren Vargas is an 11 years old and a fifth grade student at Rangerville Elementary. She is the daughter of Mr. and Mrs. Alvaro Vargas. She is the Student Council Vice President and a member of the Rangerville Rattlerettes Dance Team. Her favorite subject in school is science. During her fourth grade year, Lauren received an advanced level performance on the Reading Star Test. Her goal this year is to receive an advanced level performance on the Reading, Math, and Science Star Tests. In the future, Lauren plans to attend college and become a teacher. When asked why she wants to become a teacher, Lauren replied, "My teachers always helped me when I did not understand something, and I want to do the same for other children." During her spare time, Lauren enjoys walking her dogs and spending time with her family. Leading us in the invocation is Gracie Garcia from Rangerville Elementary. Gracie Garcia is 11 years old and a fifth grade student at Rangerville Elementary. She is the daughter of Mr. Jesus Garcia. She is the Student Council President and a member of the Rangerville Rattlerettes Dance Team. Gracie has maintained an A average every 6 weeks since first grade. Her favorite subject in school is reading. During her fourth grade year, she received an advanced level performance on the Reading and Math Star Tests. Her goal this year is to receive an advanced level performance on the Reading, Math, and Science Star Test. In the future, Gracie plans to attend Rice University and become a veterinarian because she loves all animals. In her spare time, Gracie loves to read, ride her bike, and spend time with her family. Please rise for the
Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Honor the Texas flag. I pledge allegiance to thee, Texas, one state under God, one and indivisible.
Let us bow our heads and pray. Lord Jesus, I come to you in prayer and ask that you will be with everyone represented here from administration to staff, parents, and students. I pray that you'll surround us with your love and protection and that you would continue to bless our homes. Lord Jesus, be with every school board member and our superintendent and help them to come together in the best interest of every child in order to make the right decisions in making the best education available that will prepare us for the future. May this meeting be just a step toward other meetings that will drive SBISD to continue to be recognized as a top performance in education. Provide each and every one of us a safe trip home and a good night's rest to prepare us for tomorrow. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen.
Will the parents please stand and be recognized at this time?
We move to item number five. Dr. Puig, I guess we have some special recognitions.
Yes, sir, we do. They're very special. Would you kind of like this? Would you come up and tell us the special recognitions?
Hello, good evening, everybody. We have several schools being represented here this evening. We're going to start, first of all, with Berta Cavaza Middle School. These are the students that participated in the UIL district meet that was hosted by Riverside Middle School at the Berta Cavaza Middle School campus. Principal at that campus is Mr. Ray Saldana. And I'd like to begin by introducing the students. We have some sixth graders and one seventh grader. So we'll begin by introducing Alisa Saldana, a first place winner in modern oratory competition. We have another first place winner, Caitlin Garza, impromptu speaking competition. Anilu Garza, a seventh grader, placed first with Spanish poetry competition. And I don't believe she could be present this evening. We have another student on the list, Audrey Garza, third place winner. She was unable to attend this evening. Her parents called and indicated that she would not be able to attend. But however, I did tell them that we would still read out her name. And she is prose winner, third place. Another third place winner, this is in modern oratory competition, is Sydney Castillo. Madeline Cole placed third in calculator competition. Naylan Garza placed third in Spanish poetry competition. I'd also like to recognize the UIL coordinators at the campus, Mrs. Smith and Mrs. Pessina. At this time, we would like to recognize the parents that are in the audience. If y'all are in the audience, please stand and be recognized at this time. We also have some proud grandparents in the audience. If you're grandparents or other family members, please stand and be recognized this time. Congratulations, students and teachers. Yes, great job. And we had Ms. Ileana Gonzalez doing those honors for this particular group that just left. Our next board member to join us is Hector G. Leal, and he is our vice president. He's gonna be doing the honors for students from San Benito Veterans Memorial Academy. These are the students that went to compete in the Business Professionals of America at the Regional Leadership Conference. They placed at regionals, and they are gonna advance to state. We have two students, freshmen at Veterans Memorial Academy campus. Principal there is Gilbert Galvan. The students are Hector de Jesus. He placed third. This young man competed in basic office system and procedures, and he will be advancing to state. The next student joining him is Lindsay Gore, placed second in medical office procedures, and she will also be advancing to state. The sponsor is Reynaldo Garcia. And Hector de Jesus and Lindsay Gore competed in the BPA. This is a chapter two, and they participated in the regional leadership competition January the 24th in Weslaco, Texas. They competed against other BPA high school chapters in the region, and they are advancing to the BPA state competition. And this is gonna be held March the 4th through the 7th in Dallas, Texas. So we wish them well. Thank you. And I know I saw Hector de Jesus' mom in the audience. I know she's in the audience right now. And if there's other family members in the audience for the other students on the list, please stand and be recognized at this time. And good luck at state. We move on to San Benito High School, and we have a lot of students that are on the list for various competitions. And these are students that compete extracurricular through the CTE programs that they're involved in with the clubs. The first group on the list, and we have Mr. Oscar Medrano, our secretary, doing the honors. The first student on the list is Cindy Peña. She placed third in medical assisting competition. And Cindy Peña will be advancing to state. The sponsor for this group is Dr. Anabel De Leon. And I'd also like to mention that the principal is Henry Sanchez at San Benito High School, the CTE director. He's also in the audience. And it is Mr. Hector Rendon. At this time, Cindy Peña's parents, if y'all are in the audience, please stand and be recognized at this time. And let me explain a little bit about Cindy's accomplishments. Cindy took an online test in December, and she advanced to area where she took the skills test and placed third out of 10 and advanced to state. The HOSA State Conference will be held April the 9th through the 11th at Dallas, Texas. So we wish her well. We move on to the next group from San Benito High School. These are the Texas Association of Future Educators, or the TAFE Club members. These are students that placed at the TAFE Region 1 competition, and they advanced to the Teach for Tomorrow Summit State competition. The honorees are Wilbur Padron, and Wilbur scored a 90 in the educational leadership test. So congratulations to him. We also have Victoria Vela. She scored 92, top score in the educational leadership test. And Mirna Zuniga received a top score of 90 in the educational leadership test. And Wilbert and Victoria are juniors, and Mirna is a sophomore. Their sponsor is Brenda Aguilar. And these students competed at the TAFE Region 1 Teaching is Out of This World competition December the 6th at Harlingen High School. And they will be advancing to state competition at the Teach for Tomorrow Summit February the 13th through the 15th, so it's just around the corner. And this will be held at Texas Tech University in Lubbock, Texas. Good luck. And at this time, we'd like to recognize the parents. If they're in the audience, we'd like to ask them to stand, please, and be recognized. And good luck to y'all at state. For the next group, we have Ms. Ana Cruz, one of our board members, that is doing the honors. The next group hails from San Benito High School. These are students from the Texas Association of Future Educators, or the TAFE Club members. These are students that placed at the Region 1 competition, and they advanced to the Teach for Tomorrow Summit State competition. And please help me welcome these winners. They are Sarah Gonzalez, placed first. She is a senior, and she placed first with her bulletin board project on teens and driving. Claudia Torres is another first place winner and is also a senior. With the bulletin board on teens and driving project. Stephanie Monjaraz earned a top score of a 90 in the educational leadership test. And Stephanie is a junior at San Benito High School. Christian Aguilar, a top score of 90 in the educational leadership test. Congratulations. And Christian is a junior. Another top score of a 90 in the educational leadership test is Vanessa Barbosa. a junior, and Thalia Becerra, top score 92 in the educational leadership test, and Vanessa is a senior. Excuse me, Thalia is a senior. The sponsor is Dolores de la Fuente, and I believe she's here this evening. And these are students that placed at the TAFE Region 1 Teaching is Out of This World competition. They went to compete December the 6th at Harlingen High School. They are advancing to the TAFE State Competition at the Teach for Tomorrow Summit, February the 13th through the 15th at Texas Tech University in Lubbock. And so we want to wish them well when they go off to compete and represent San Benito CISD and San Benito High School. Parents, if y'all are in the audience, please stand and be recognized at this time. And good luck to y'all. Mm-hmm. Yes, ma'am. We have our board member, Ms. Fatima Huerta, doing the honors for the next group. From San Benito High School, these are the Distributive Education Clubs of America, District 1 Career Development Conference winners. And they are first place winner, Jose Angel Villarreal. Jose Angel Villarreal is a senior, and he competed in business law and the ethics team. We also have Jennifer L. Ramirez, also first place with the business law and ethics team. We have another senior, Jessica M. Zuniga, first place. This was with the buying and merchandising team. Jessica is a senior. We have Rolando A. Cruz, first place winner with the buying and merchandising team. Rolando is a senior. We have Tristan Naranjo, first place, buying and merchandising team, and Tristan is a senior. We have the sponsor, Mr. Roland Garcia, who's joining his students here this evening. And he has another group, so you'll be meeting him in a little bit. These are students that went to compete at the Texas DECA District 1 Career Development Conference, January the 21st in McAllen, Texas. They will be advancing to the DECA State Career Development Conference, February the 25th through the 27th in Dallas, Texas. So we want to wish them well. Congratulations. Great job. Parents of these students, if y'all are in the audience, we'd like for you to stand and be recognized at this time. And again, their sponsor is Mr. Roland Garcia, and you'll meet him in a little bit. He has another group of winners. Joining the group of winners, these are DECA District 1 Career Development Conference winners. These are students that placed a district competition, and they're advancing to the DECA State Career Development Conference. Please help me welcome Giselle Schoenmakers, a first place winner from San Benito High School. He's a senior. And we have Mr. Angel Mendez doing the honors. Giselle is a member of the buying and merchandising team that placed first. We also have Ariana K. Agado, first place in the sports entertainment marketing team. And we have Florestela Limas, first place winner in the sports entertainment marketing team. And she is a sophomore, and I don't believe she could make it this evening. We have two seniors on the list. They are Leandra E. Guevara, first place winner with the sports entertainment marketing team. And we also have Justin Lozano, first place sports entertainment marketing team winner, also a senior. And their sponsor is Roland Garcia. And there is Mr. Roland Garcia. And these are the students that are going to be advancing to the state competition. It's coming up around the corner, February the 25th through the 27th in Dallas, Texas. So we want to wish them well when they go out and represent their school and in our school district. So we're very proud of your accomplishments. And I know so are your parents. Parents, if y'all are in the audience, please stand and be recognized at this time. Congratulations and good luck at state. The next groups are being sponsored by their teacher and sponsor, Francis Thrailkill. And these are students from San Benito High School. These are the Business Professionals of America. These are the students that went to compete at the BPA Regional Leadership Conference. And we have our board president, Mr. Arnold Padilla, doing the honors for the following students. Juan Sosa, first place, is a state qualifier, and he is a senior. He advanced in Microsoft Word. We have San Benito High School junior, Michael Perez, third place state qualifier with spreadsheet applications. We have a senior, Karina Castillo, second place state qualifier in parliamentarian procedures. Julissa Limon is a second place state qualifier in broadcast production. And she's also a senior. We have junior Alex Martinez, third place website design and a state alternate, is a junior at San Benito High School. Joshua Castañeda, third place website design state alternate winner, is a senior. Ashley Ochoa, third place junior at San Benito High School website design and is a state alternate. And Nadia Hernandez, second place broadcast production state alternate winner. Nadia Hernandez is a senior. And Frances Thrailkill is a sponsor, and you'll meet her in a little bit. She has a couple of more students on the list. Joining these winners are other students. We have Amanda Ortiz, third place winner in human resource management. Amanda is a junior at San Benito High School. And the following winners that I'll be calling, these are all third place state qualifier winners in the parliamentarian procedures. And they are Abigail Hernandez, Eddie Lugo, Alex Barrientos, Jose Barajas, Arturo Alemán, Armando Alemán, and Silvia Cavazos. And their sponsor is Francis Thrailkill. And again, these students went to compete at the Business Professionals of America Regional Leadership Conference. It was held January the 24th at Weslaco East High School in Weslaco. These are the students that are going to be advancing to the BPA State Conference, and they will compete in Dallas March the 4th through the 7th. So we want to wish them well. Congratulations. And good luck at state. It's around the corner. Please. Parents, if y'all are in the audience, please stand and be recognized at this time. Thank you. And congratulations, Ms. Thrailkill. We have Ms. Ilana Gonzalez doing the honors for this next group joining us, and they are the last group of the night from San Benito High School. These are your Business Professionals of America, regional competition winners and state qualifiers, state alternates. We also have one scholarship recipient. Please help me welcome Robert Diaz, a third place winner, state qualifier. And integrated office applications. And Robert is a junior at San Benito High School. Joining him is Rebecca Cañate, third place winner, state alternate, presentation management team. We also have Christian Cano, third place state alternate, presentation management team member. Christian is a senior. We have Mayor Rasmussen, second place state qualifier. PC servicing and troubleshooting. Maya is a senior at San Benito High School. We have one junior, Marisa Alejandro, first place winner, state qualifier, advanced interview skills. We have San Benito High School senior, Bianca Jimenez, placed third, is a state alternate. With a presentation management team. Joining them is Melissa Jimenez, San Benito High School senior, and she is the recipient of a $500 scholarship. Great job. Joining them is their sponsor, Irma Isabel Perez. Congratulations to these fine students. These are the students that went to compete at the Business Professionals of America at the 2015 Regional Leadership Conference, January the 24th at Weslaco East High School in Weslaco, Texas. They participated in various competitive events and placed for state qualifier or state alternate positions. And those advancing will go to the State Leadership Conference in Dallas, Texas, March the 4th through the 7th. So we want to wish them continued success. Parents, if y'all are in the audience, please stand and be recognized at this time. Congratulations, Ms. Perez, and good luck to y'all. Thank you. Thank you. That concludes the special recognition portion. Thank you.
Great job, Dr. Wade. Lots of wonderful talent that we have here in San Benito.
Yes,
wonderful talent. Move to item number 6, superintendent's report.
Thank you, Mr. Board President, trustees. A couple of things I want to start with. First of all, is I want to thank CASA, the Student Advocacy Organization, put on a wonderful event last week to raise a lot of money for a group of children that often experience some very difficult situations. So I want to applaud that event and the Harlem Ambassadors who came, put on a wonderful show for everyone. So I just want to applaud them. I also want to thank last night Luis Garcia and Luis Gonzalez letting us use the Prayer and Involvement Center last night. And then we kind of crashed it so we could have a board budget workshop, so it was wonderful. So thank you, Mr. Gonzalez. Trustees, we've covered a lot of the overnight trips, but there's one I want to highlight. I know you've read them, but I want to highlight A. And this happened last week, but the San Benito Special Services traveled to Austin for the Special Olympics, and it was quite amazing to be part of that send-off. I wish we all could have been there, but to see those kids so fired up and ready to go and compete, it just makes what we do worth it, so it was awesome. Just want to highlight that. I want to get into the enrollment updates and some more specificity than maybe we've had before in the past. I've given you a manila envelope, and you don't have to take apart the first items. There's about 25 pages in here. I'm just not going to go through all of them, but I just want to highlight two things. The very first page in the upper right-hand corner, that's our enrollment today. That's where we stand today as a district. And at your leisure time, which I know none of you have, you can go through some of the detail there at the bottom where all the elementary schools, at the top of the secondary schools. So that's the enrollment. If you turn to the very last page, if you would please, the very, very last page of this document, the very top, it's titled San Benito CISD, and it has all your grade levels from left to right. If you go all the way over to the total column, and then all the way down, at the very bottom, you'll see your district-wide percent attendance. It's 95.61. It's okay. Happy, but not satisfied. And you can also go across and see what grade levels are performing very well, and what grade levels aren't performing so well. We know in the very early grades, those are our little babies, they get sick, so, you know, that's okay. We understand that. They're, you know, those early grades. take a look at that as well. Also, right above that percent attendance number, that's the number how we get paid. Right above that number, all the way to the right, the 95%, right above that's our refined ADA. We get paid on that number. It's about 10,055. Pretty solid. We've seen that fluctuate plus or minus 100 students in a given 6 weeks. So I just want to make sure you have those. Secondly, in your manila folder, you have a series of documents I want to go through. Of course, I go through the various goals. You know, we have four goals that we set out as a 90-day entry plan, and you're familiar with those: governance, finance, academics, and community relations. I want to highlight those a little bit. If we just continue to look at the goal form, to the left you have goal number one, and what have we done? What have we indicated that we're working towards government? How can we substantiate that? And I've highlighted a few things. Under goal one, governance, ensuring effective board superintendent relations, we know we just completed a workshop yesterday. Tier three, focusing on fiscal health, reviewing the budget process, and really looking at potential options to remedy some of the financial challenges we're experiencing. To the right, I have some comments dealing with goal number one, and you'll see we still have the standard operating procedure handbook that we're working on that we're going to finalize in March, and I appreciate the rich discussion we had as a team last night on that. The second goal I want to get into is, of course, reviewing the efficiency of the organization, the financial review, and with that, I'm going to get up and show a few slides, not only to the board, but also to the public so they can see what we talked about a little bit here, so allow me to... And my able assistant no longer has my pointer. Thank you, ma'am. Lights, gentlemen. Ideally, what happened on Q, right? Lights and the whole house. That always worked out. Trustees, and of course, this is a public meeting, so I want to make sure that you see this. I know for the audio recording, they told me to move over here because they can't hear me. So for their, I'll move this. I'd like to stand around. But let me just go through a couple of slides. You know, I ask about the financial situation. How serious is it? Well, we've got a challenge, but it's just, it's really an opportunity, right? In disguise. How do we improve our efficiency? That's all it is. I don't want anyone to say, oh my goodness, the sky is falling. It's not. But we didn't get here overnight. So let's just talk about a few things. The first big thing we want to talk about is the fund balance profile in millions. And just looking at the five-year fund balance in 5 years. And so the trustees, I know we talked about this last night. We had an audit reported on January 22nd. And so when you see the five-year trend, what you're looking here is your total fund balance. What do you have in your checking account, to explain it in the simplest terms? And that's the total amount we've had back in 09 to what we have today. And what you'll see is, in yellow, a portion of that is your unreserved general fund. That's what you can spend. They call it unassigned. It's not allocated to a specific program. That number in yellow is not allocated to a construction project, or it is, or it's not, I'm sorry. It's just, well, you can use it for any particular use that's legal. And you can see that over the last 5 years, it's kind of dwindled. And then we took a substantial drop. And the trustees are well aware of it. I want to make sure the public is aware of this as well. But we've had some issues with the health insurance plan that we have. So we had to do a large transfer out of the fund balance to cover a lot of those expenses in the health insurance plan that we fund here in the district. Now, when you combined the loss in the fund balance and some of those challenges with challenges that we've experienced with maybe hiring practices that may not have been most effective, just so you understand where we're going, and let me explain this chart. It's not as confusing as it appears. My wife said it was very difficult to understand. I don't think it is. What you have here is the enrollment. So here's your total enrollment here in 10-11. You see I kind of went up a little bit, just a few students. And then we had a decline, probably due to some competition, right? We're not the only game in town anymore, are we? We have charter schools, IDEA, open enrollment. you know, there's another game in town, but that's okay. We like that as an opportunity for us to improve the way we market our district and improve our offerings. That's okay. So we lost some kiddos, right? The number in black right here, the larger number, that's your FTEs. That's just your full-time equivalent. How many staff members do you have? That's all that is. And right below that number is the ratio of total students. If you have a calculator, you can take that number right there, divide it by that number right there, and you get your ratio, how many total students to staff. Now, why is the ratio important? Well, every year we get an evaluation called the FIRST report, the Financial Integrity Rating System of Texas, that kind of tells you, hey, there's some indicators here. We look at 20 indicators or so, and those indicators tell you kind of an idea of how good you are. And you get rated. In fact, we've been rated superior achievement for several years. That's pretty good, but it doesn't tell the whole story, just the tip of the iceberg. Now, the ratio, which is an indicator number 17, and you could care less what the indicator is. All it does is, what ratio should you be in at a district this size? What ratio should we be in? And you get so many points. If your ratio for a district with more than 10,000 students, your ratio should be within a minimum of 7 and a high of 14. Now, we are just below 7, and we have been, and dropping. So naturally, as this is a $100 million business that we are all responsible for, not just the trustees, not just the superintendent, but everyone who's a CEO of their department in this district, principals, directors. If you're running a department, you are a CEO of your department, and you play a role in this. We all do. It's a team effort. So I want you to understand, if that number dips below 7, danger, Will Robinson. Remember that? I'm old. Man, danger. Some of you are laughing because you remember that. We're in trouble a little. Somebody said, I remember that. We're in trouble a little bit. And I don't mean to say trouble. It just means we got to look closer at what we're doing as an organization. How do we run this like a business? Because if we run it like a business and put money back in the classroom, we help kids. It's that simple. So I want you to look carefully at that. But here's the piece that I really want everyone to understand. When this number goes down, these FTEs need to kind of stay with it. They kind of need to trend together, right? If enrollment's going down, well, probably the staffing needs to kind of stay paired. Otherwise, you're going to start to create some funding issues. And that's kind of where we've been. It didn't happen overnight, but it's kind of happened over time. I could show you for 10 years, and you've kind of seen it. But really, the reason you want to highlight the last 5 years, because that's where it's really taken off. And here's the stark difference right here. If you look between 2013 and today, between 2013 and today, we had 616 folks on 2013 but when we took this little snapshot right here. I've seen it vary in some data. That's actually your first data. That says 1616. I saw another document that said 1636, so we'll call it 1616 because that's on TA's website. In between 2013 and 2014-15, we increased by 100. We increased. So we dropped in enrollment, but we increased in staff by the same number of kids that we lost. It's like a one-to-one ratio almost. You lost one kid, you hired one person. Now, I don't know how many entrepreneurs there are in the audience, and I know we have some entrepreneurs here, but this is just a reality. We don't want to, you know, it's, again, the sky's not falling, but let's keep it real for the taxpayer, right? These folks here, they're elected officials. They're trustees. They're not politicians. They've been entrusted to protect the owners, and the owners are the taxpayers and the children. That's why they're here. So that's why we're having this conversation. You know, we're going to solve it. We're going to fix it together. It's going to be tough, but we're going to do it. But that whole loss in that one little period there, if you just take the average compensation package, because a lot of those folks were auxiliary folks, 100 times a $30,000 compensation package is about $3 million. Now, that $3 million could have gone to salary increases for everybody. In fact, I want to say TASB made a recommendation for salary increases, and one of the models they gave was probably that amount. So I say this, and I'm speaking to the board tonight, but I'm also wanting the public to understand the opportunity before us. Not a challenge, the opportunity for us to rethink the way we do our business, the way we work together as a team, the way the CEOs of the department that run this district
run their departments. The way that you community members go out and tell the truth about what's happening. Hey, it's okay. Yeah, we've had some challenges. Let's fix it. Stand up and say something positive about what we're doing here. These folks don't get paid a dime for what they do, but they're going to do the right thing for the taxpayers and the children. I tell you that. I know. I've worked with them. Now, that being said, is hope coming? Do we know? Well, do we have any evidence of that? Well, sure we do. Before I get into the hope, let me another reality check. These campuses, again, if we're running a business, you need to know as a taxpayer, how efficient are they? These are all of your elementary campuses. Ideally, to run a business, you want them to be about 80 to 85% full. If they're 80 to 85, I tell you what, they're 100% staffed. But are they efficient in terms of having enough students? Because not only do you have to educate them with personnel, you've got to heat and cool that building and serve food. And that number is not even included right here. That's just personnel. So let me give you a little window into efficiency and what we're doing here as a district and analyzing the situation. This is just the tip of the iceberg. We're going to go a whole lot deeper into the water. But if you look at some of these campuses, I've highlighted those in red that are only less than two-thirds full. Landrum has an enrollment of 301. Its capacity is 506. It's just over half full. Cost that much to run it. Personnel only, not heating and cooling. And that's how much per student. La Paloma, less than two-thirds full. Dr. Garza, just over half full. Ed Downs, just over 60%. And really, the only ones that are at 80% efficiency, you got La Encantada. Fred Booth is knocking on the door there. That's a building that's 91 years old, by the way. Frank Roberts, 84%. Dr. Cash, 81%. Leal is about 78%, one of our country schools. So again, I want you to just go out and understand that to give the children the best educational experience possible, we've got to make sure we're spending the money right. Because if we're spending the money right, that means we're being efficient. If we're being efficient, we're putting more money back into the classroom. Well, who's in the classroom? Teachers. Teachers in the classroom. So we are as efficient as possible in the way we staff. We can pay teachers and principals competitive wages so we have the best life changer in front of the kid every day. But this didn't happen overnight, did it? If you think it happened overnight, you haven't been paying attention. I just got to be honest, people. You're a taxpayer in here. You got to watch this stuff. You need to demand that you know what's happening. Because they're going to demand it from me. And they should demand it from me. They're going to hold me accountable to saying, hey, Dr. Puig, I need to see this. I need to see that. Yes, ma'am. Yes, sir. Here it is. High school, a little more efficient than high schools and middle schools. High school is about 74%. I know we've heard it's busting at the seams, but I could squeeze 700 more kids in there. Let me get them in there. Mr. Sanchez, where are you? There you go. I mean, no, sir, it's crowded. No, it's not. I got 700 more kids here. VMA is 90%. Tell you what, I see VMA, that's a big campus. We don't have any money yet right now, but I'd like to see that expand into one of the best magnet academies in the nation. There's a lot of real estate out there we can do with that one. BC, 86. The middle schools here, Miller Jordan, just two-thirds, and then, of course, Riverside. The reason you're seeing a lot of disparity between BC and Miller Jordan is because of the PEG list, right? So parents can say, hey, I want to transfer my child to BC. They can do that. Not quite at capacity, and these numbers aren't dead on. I mean, there's some variations, obviously. So when I say it's 86% full, it's probably between 86 and 88, you know, on any given day because of the transfers that are going on. And that's how much it costs to each one. Now, what I want to say is this. We've already saved money from January 5th, the day we came together as a team, till the 6th here of February, a short time, a month, we've already saved $1 million through resignation. And I'm going to speak for the board. They appreciate your applause. And let me tell you why. The job is very challenging to educate kids well. Anyone can teach, but how many can teach really well? We've got a lot of great educators right in the room right here. I see them. They're here. But they need to be paid a competitive wage. It's going to take time. So I'm asking directors and principals, parents, family, community members, spread the word that we're working on it. We need some time and patience. Give these folks time and patience. We've already started in 1 month, $1 million. There's more to be found, and we will. We're going to partner with some great people to help us find some more money. But we have to do it for the future of our kids, and I mean that. I mean that, and I trust you do too. We're going to focus on being a system here. We can have some schools that are excellent, but to make an entire school system excellent is going to take some work. It's going to take that teamwork.
Couple more items. That was goal number two. Goal number three, I just want to highlight something. I won't go through the presentation, but I want you to have this. These are the latest benchmark results. And I'm sorry, I'm in folder three. I'm all over the place tonight. A lot of paper. This has the latest secondary benchmark results. And I just want to show one item to you, if you'll allow me to show you one item. Page 2, and we know we've changed the TEKS for math. It's going to be very challenging. We know this. How challenging is it going to be? Well, I asked our secondary curriculum director to put the benchmark at 70%. And what would that be? What would the results be? Well, you see, as a district, only 2% of secondary kids met the math standard at 70%. 2%. Now, trustees, that's the tip of this iceberg here. That's why what we do here is so important. Citizens, parents, teachers, everything we do is about fixing our system where it's efficient and effective, because it starts here, and then it starts there, and then it happens in the classroom. Trustees, I ask that you please read this in its entirety in the next coming days, and that our next workshop we talk a little bit more in depth about it. I'll say again on goal number three, we are having a retreat with the principals that I will lead on February 16th at VMA. VMA has been gracious enough to lend us their facilities, and all the principals and curriculum directors will be there for that. Again, goal number three is academic assessment. Are we getting our return on investment? Goal number four is community relations, developing public trust and confidence. What evidence and indicators can I say that we've done to show that we're addressing the need to develop the community relations? Well, I'm excited that I was invited to a parent center meeting this Friday, the 13th. I can't wait. And so I'm getting to meet parents and talking about what's on their heart, what's going on with them. I was able to go to the San Benito Housing Development Corporation to make a presentation about a grand idea, because I want to say something here, and trustees, I've said it to you, and I'll say it to the public here. Just because the money looks challenging doesn't mean we stop innovating. We have to be creative. We have to. We can never stop being creative. So we have to remember how important that is. The sky is not falling. This is an opportunity, not a challenge. So, yes, you will see us partnering together to come up with great ideas to make San Benito the best in the valley, the premier district. And so the Stonewall idea, no, we're not buying a building. Trustees, did I ever come to you with that?
Nope.
For the record, I've never come to you guys and said, we're buying a building. They would have said, sir, you're fired. You're not going to be here anymore. What's wrong with you? No, we propose an idea that's exciting for kids that would set us apart from everyone in the valley. That's what we proposed. An instructional hospitality hotel that repurposes one of the most beautiful historic hotels I have ever seen. That's what we proposed. So spread the word. It's truth. Okay. And then finally, I'll say this and some comments related to community relations. We are extending that statewide, aren't we? We're going to the Winter Governance Legal Seminar, and some of us are going to present together on March 5th. And guess what? The San Benito High School Flamenco Group is going to perform in front of all the trustees in the state of Texas. So give them a big round of applause. Mr. Board President, trustees, thank you.
Dr. Puig, thank you very much. Before I move on to item number 7, I'm just going to say one thing real quick. I appreciate what you've just done because I think it was important for everyone to understand the situation we're in and for everyone to understand the hard work that is going on behind the scenes, the amount of meetings that we're doing, the continuous dialogue. Simply put, we knew and we understood where we were. We knew and we understood where we needed to be. And part of the way out of there was the hiring of you, sir. So that's part of the process. So I appreciate what you've done, presented to the community what is truly going on. We'll move forward. More importantly, this is just a simple way to move things forward and realign this district. And as I stated a couple of months back, pay our teachers what they should be paying, getting paid, and all of our auxiliary staff. But we got to fix what's broken before we can get there. And I'm confident we're going to do it without any problem. Do we have anybody? Item number 7 is public comment. Anyone register for public
yes,
comment?
Yes, we do, sir. This time, Ms. Garcia.
The elections are held close to the pavilion, the Veterans Pavilion, and there has been some concern that a lot of activity is going on close to the pavilion through the years, and now maybe since you're on board, maybe you have thought, maybe you could think about maybe moving the early voting site to the where the city votes, and we could have it hand in hand, because the city votes loses votes, or the school district loses votes because they have to go to one place to vote and then go to another place to vote. So that's a concern of mine. Another topic that I wanted to bring up, well, your wonderful idea and y'all about the Stonewall Jackson. Yes, it did get out of hand. Okay, there's no money and we're already thinking about purchasing the Stonewall Jackson. And that's the way it came across. And you can't blame the public or the taxpayers for thinking that but I'm sure you have, it's a long-term idea and it's wonderful. Then the way you spoke tonight, that was wonderful, the superintendent, and that's another thing that maybe you could have an open forum with the public at night, an hour, maybe every 2 months. Maybe they could submit a topic for you in advance so you could make good use of the time. Of course, I mean, I don't have to tell you how to run it, but something like that, like it used to be a PTA where the public, the taxpayers, and if it doesn't work out, but you could give it a try. And also, I would like to publicly thank our former superintendent for all the commitment he gave to San Benito School District. And last, roses are red, violets are blue, be fair and honest. That is what I humbly ask of you. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else register for public comments?
No, sir.
Okay. In order to promote efficient meetings, the board may act upon more than one item by a single vote through the use of a consent agenda. Consent items placed on the agenda shall be marked with an asterisk. Consent items are for which no board discussion is anticipated and for which the superintendent recommends approval. Prior to the time of the approval, consent agenda is had at the request of any member of the Board of Trustees. Any item of the consent agenda shall be removed and given individual consideration. Move to business and finance, again, 1502A1. Discuss and consider approval of consulting agreement with Moat Casey and Associates. 1502A2, request for approval of proposals pertinent to the Universal Service Education Rate, E-Rate 17, year 2015. 1502A3, request for approval of 2014-2015 budget amendments. 1502A4, request for approval of 2014-15 budget transfers. Under administration, 1502A5, approval of 2014-2015 summer school program. I do understand that there is a request by the superintendent to table item 1502A6 and 1502A7. We'll move to 1502.
Mr. President, I'm sorry for interrupting, yes. But I may clarify to you that my request was you'd like us to go through the committee just to thoroughly vet yes. those new policies.
Yes, thank you. No. 1502A8, request for approval of the May 9th, 2015 order of election for the purpose of electing the Board of Trustees of the Samuel Consolidated Independent School District members to fill places 1, 2, and 3. Question? 1502A9, discuss, consider approval of contract for the election services for the Cameron County Elections Department. Question? 1502A10, request for approval of board minutes. I'll ask for a motion to approve all those items not in question.
Second.
There's a motion by Hector Leal. There's a second by Oscar Medrano. All those in favor state by saying aye.
Aye.
Those against, motion passes. We'll be back to item 1502A8. I understand we have the county who would want to make a presentation on this item.
Yes, Mr. Davis, if you would please join us. He's the Cameron County.
Trustees, Dr. Puig, thank you. What a segue, efficiency. That's what I'm here to offer, I hope, is being efficient. Y'all are in the business of running school districts, City of San Benito, who we've also reached out to, is in the business of running cities. I'm Chris Davis, Cameron County Elections Administrator. I'm in the business of running elections. And I've been on the job for 2 years. I've served a full election cycle, started in 2013. So I don't know how often, or how long rather, the San Benito Consolidated Independent School District has run their own elections. But what I'm presenting to you tonight, what I'm asking the board to consider, of trustees to consider, is that the County Elections Department run your elections. We've reached out to the City of San Benito. They've agreed, they've voted to have us run their elections. And I think you can find cost savings and efficiency and economies of scale, a way to conduct elections in uniform with the election code, with the law. That's not to say that elections as they've been conducted in the past haven't been according to the law. I'm sure they have been, but there's ways to make it easier for the voter. There's ways to lower hurdles for the voter. I heard the public commenter and her concern about voters going, having to vote with overlaying districts, the school district in the city, having to go to different places to vote. Ideally, the goal should be for everybody is to minimize that. Because although our office hasn't conducted your elections in quite a while, I can assure you we receive the complaints from voters just as much as y'all do, or just as much as your administration and your staff do. They do great work running the school district, and having them run elections on top of the everyday, day-to-day affairs that they have to has got to be a challenge. I know I couldn't do it. But we're here. We think there could be some cost savings with sharing sites, consolidating sites, having a joint early voting sites, as well as a couple of joint election day sites, possibly even, well, there's options and there's ways to save funds. So I'm here to answer any questions, address any concerns. There's also another, before I open that up, there's another district, the Port Isabel San Benito Navigation District, that may indeed have elections this time around. I've been told that they haven't since 2004. But if they do, even greater cost savings and efficiencies are to be had, because their district is quite large and it encompasses almost all of the school district's territory and the precincts involved there. I'll know more by the end of the candidate filing deadline, which I believe is February 27th, 28th, end of the month. So there's even more greater potential to save.
Mr. Davis, I've got a couple of questions. I understand that when the proposal was brought to us, there were three options that were proposed. And, of course, one was the consideration of the district on its own. One, if the city came in as a partner, and then, of course, of the navigation district.
Yes, sir.
But a little earlier, before the meeting, I was presented with a revised proposal, which only included one of three options. It did state that the city of San Manuel would be a part of this proposal, but I'm a little concerned because it is identical to option number two, but yet the cost went up. The cost went up by $4,000.
That's right.
Why?
The reason why is my assumption with option two that the board or the trustees were, the district was originally given, was that the city of San Benito would share five election day sites. I anticipated this question, Mr. Padilla, and I printed out the map. So I can, and those five sites would have been election day sites, mind you. The community building, San Benito Community Building on Haywood, Fire Station Number 1, Fred Booth Elementary School, La Paloma Elementary School, and the Los Indios Community Center. Those five right there are already five of your seven election day sites that you've traditionally used. I anticipated the city wanting to use those as well. City, I'm sure all of you are aware, the city traditionally has only had one election day site. What I believe to be the source of voter discontent and confusion, where they could go to one of seven locations on election day, and I think that's great that the district had, but inevitably, if they fell within city limits, they'd have to go to four of those five places would have to go to one site for the city. The city decided to go with only two election day sites. They increased it, but only enough. Baby steps are being taken by the city. So because the district will be sharing less election day sites than I anticipated. They'll only be sharing two if the district decides to go this way and keep their sites. And that would be the community building and Fire Station Number 1. The city's not using Fred Booth. They're not using Los Indios Community Center. And they're not using La Paloma.
Just out of curiosity, your anticipation was based on what?
Any discussions? The anticipation was that the city was going to, I was trying to get them to follow the school district's election sites and have the and reduce basically the voter inconvenience, which is paramount to my office. Y'all pay the bill at the end of the day. I know fiduciary responsibilities and concerns are of equal importance, but having voters travel less to vote in both elections that they're qualified to vote for was my goal, and I pleaded with them. All they would go and agree to was up to one other election day site and not the two.
Okay. The other question I had I see that there's a, in this agreement, that the participating authority, which is, of course, in this case is the district, needs to name or appoint its presiding judge.
The presiding judge, I believe, for the early vote ballot board, if I'm not mistaken, if that's the section that you're talking about in the contract. And that's correct. I left it blank at the will of the board. What's typically done, and in May of even-numbered years, of course, we have the City of Brownsville election, we have City of Rio Hondo. Those are joint elections that we've run, and we've had one presiding judge of the early vote ballot board to preside over the mail-in ballots. This is what this is the absentee ballots that come in. We've yet to name that person. That's one of the reasons I left it blank. And the other reason is if the school district individually or if the school district wants to partner up and have a joint appointment for that presiding judge, they're welcome to. That opens a door on some other decisions that may need to be made down the line and not necessarily tonight, such as does a school district want to have a joint ballot with the city? That means all elections on one ballot, more than likely on the same face, on the front face of the ballot, for those voters in the city. There's cost savings to be had there. I wasn't making that assumption tonight that that ballot would be joint. But if it is joint, that means that one board needs to be going over the ballots, and that's one presiding judge. So there are a lot of variables that hadn't been decided at the time of presentation tonight, thus the blank in that contract.
Okay. So if we approve the intent or approve the agreement, will those deciding factors come back to this board for decision?
Yes.
Okay.
And I will say this, trustees, I want to make it a little clear, and I appreciate it entertaining tonight. When it comes back to the way we set the topic of conversation, we are in the teaching and learning business, and right now we're also in the balancing the budget business. And we need all hands on deck right now in the budget office to focus on the opportunity before us. Running elections, I've done it in other districts, and shifted to the county in my last district. Very effective, so we were focusing on the budget. There's a lot of time, energy, and effort it's going to require us to tackle the opportunity before us in the budget. This frees us up to do that a little bit more. Number two, there is the potential cost savings, potential. And some of it can be very dramatic, and some of it can just be marginal. But I can't put a price tag on what I said a moment ago, is freeing up my team to focus on the budget. And then finally, and you know how I feel about politics, I don't want them in the school. And so this is an opportunity for us to separate ourselves and start that new culture here of, hey, you know, we're not in the politician business. We are in the trustee business and administration business. And those are really the 3 points I'm coming from with this, sir, and trustees.
Mr. Davis, I had a question. We usually would appoint election judges, clerks, and all of that personnel. Would it be possible for us to provide you all with a list and you contact them?
You can provide us with a list.
Okay.
Expect I'll afford the city the same opportunity.
Okay.
More than likely, though, we're probably going to go with folks that know how we work and that have worked our primaries and our general elections. Because as many election day sites as y'all had in the San Benito area, I promise you we had more. And the primaries in March, the runoffs in May, and the general election in November. But absolutely. More than likely, I wouldn't be surprised if there's some overlap in your list and our list. And because they're just folks that are very, very good and like to run elections, and they do it well. Yes, sir, Mr. Mendez.
When the ballots are in, are you taking the ballots back to the county, or are you counting them here in-house and disclosing the outcome here locally?
That's a good question, sir. And as far as the logistics, we have our central count will be in Brownsville at Cameron County. That's how we conduct our election. It's one location where we bring in and we have our machines, because whether we're doing and we can do precinct tabulators, which are where the ballots are actually tabulated as they go in the machine for early voting at your, I believe, one or two early voting sites, whatever is decided with the two entities. those cards will be kept secure under lock and key, the early voting results, and the election day results will be going through the machine. They will be brought, more than likely, with a constable escort from the San Benito area to Brownsville. All candidates, the district can assign authorities, all candidates can assign poll watchers to accompany them from the polling places all the way to Central Count in Brownsville until the results are released. Once the results are printed out, the district authority will review them and approve them before they're disseminated to the public and to candidates and the trustees. But the short answer to your question is, our model is having all these returns go to Brownsville for tabulation and release.
I guess the last question is I know that you've been there 2 years, and I knew the gentleman that was there before you.
It's a great man, well. Yes, sir.
The issue being is the county has only run county elections. Has it ever run city elections and or school districts?
So absolutely, we do.
You do?
For decades, yes, sir.
Okay, which school districts have you been running?
BISD was in November. Okay. Los Fresnos ISD, La Feria ISD, Santa Maria ISD.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
So he kind of runs the gamut of the scale.
Good question. That's what I wanted to thank you very much. Any additional questions?
We'll get a price comparison before we bring it back.
Well, I think this price point, we're going to prove it with the idea there will be some variables that we're going to come back to.
That's correct.
Yeah.
You can almost, well, I don't know if it's a good term to say, but this is almost a worst case estimate.
Yes, that's what I thought.
A highest estimate.
Yeah.
All we can do is go down, or only more costs can be shared, either with the city, if they were to reconsider adding more election day sites, and I'm still working on them, folks, and with the navigation district coming on board.
Good question. So you know how much we've spent over the last 5 years. It's between $25,000 and $31,000. Last year was $31,000, but it has ranged between, at least the last 5 years, about $25,000 to they're up to $31,000. Yes, sir.
So what we're saying is, cost-wise, there's not a big difference. You're more looking at more from the efficiency of time and concentrating our efforts on other matters.
Exactly.
Okay. Any additional questions? I'll ask for a motion to approve items 1508A8
so
and 1502A9. So moved. There's a motion by Oscar Medrano, second by Ana Cruz. All those in favor, state by saying
aye. Aye.
Excuse me. All those against, motion passes. Next item on the agenda is closed meeting. Discussion under the authority of Texas Government Code 551071.
You asked for a question on item number 9.
Well, I think it was, they were combined. They were together and I asked for the action together.
Okay.
Yeah.
Right. I just wanted to clarify.
Mr. Board President, I would like us to allow Mo Casey to come up and speak. Even though it's been approved, I would like them to present what it is you approve.
Okay.
At this time, Board President, trustees, I'd like to call up Mr. Larry Throm from Mo Casey and Associates and talk a little bit about the work that you all approved tonight, what that process is going to look like, when's it going to bend, some of the timelines associated with that, and maybe some questions as well.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Larry Throm. I'm an associate with Mo Casey and Associates. We're a 12-man group out of Austin. We've been there for some 30 years. Our only clients are school districts. And we represent currently over 380 school districts. I've worked with numerous districts in the Valley. I personally have worked with Laferia, Edcouch, Edinburgh, La Jolla, Hidalgo, Sherryland, Brownsville, and McAllen. Other members of our firm have worked with Harlingen, Laredo, Lyford, Far San Juan, Raymondville, Rio Hondo, Point Isabel. We work with all the large school districts in the state of Texas, all of them. From Houston is a client of ours, Dallas is a client, Fort Worth is a client, Waco, Amarillo, Lubbock, Ysleta, El Paso, Austin, and others in between. I share that with you, this is our only business, is working with school districts. I've had 40 years of public school business. I retired 4 years ago. And during that time, I worked with my smallest school district. It was Cameron in Milam County, 1600, when I was a young man. And I started teaching school, and I was a transportation director and a maintenance director. And about my eighth year, I became an assistant superintendent of finance in the district. Districts of your size, the closest one to you in size would have been Victoria. For 2 years, I was assistant superintendent of Victoria, 83 to 85. Later on, for 10 years, I was the CFO for Lubbock. And they have 28,000 students, so they're a little bit bigger. Then I went to Austin for 10 years. They have 80,000 students. And I went up to Dallas my last 2 years, and they have 157,000 students. But all of them they all have a food service department, they all have a warehouse, virtually all of them have a police department, they got a business office, they're running payroll, they have curriculum, they have campuses, they got libraries, they're just different scales. When I see a list of your, I believe it was one high school, and then three middle school, junior highs, and about 8 or 10 elementary, it's just more of them, all right? So. And the unique thing about the state of Texas and public ed is that we only deal, I can't say only, there's one person that deals with curriculum and accountability and assessments and helps schools in that area, disaggregating their data and so forth, so you can focus on the, maybe it's not the whole campus, maybe it's not the total fourth grade, but it's one teacher that's causing that. And it's one teacher in this subject and one teacher in this, but that's not what I'm here to talk about. I'm here to talk about the finance part of it. And that's what I focus on. And one of the things that we have is a superintendent transition review. And our firm has made a proposal to do that, and also a staffing analysis comparing you over time and then comparing you to peer districts, which the superintendent and staff will choose and tell us, I want you to compare us to these districts. The superintendent alluded to some of that staffing information as far as efficiency and where you need to be on the state scale, right, to just help districts. I mean, if you got a one-to-one ratio of teacher and student, that is not good, right? So right now you have what I saw up there was a 6.6 or a 6.7 students per one teacher. Well, a more efficient would be, on their suggestion, was 7 or 14. Well, if you have 14 and you currently have 6.6, you got twice too many teachers, and I'm not saying you do, but to get to that ratio, you would. So we're aware of some of the difficulties you have, and as the superintendent comes in, he's got his audit report, and it was brought to the board in January, and you've had the same auditor for a number of years. I've looked back, and back to 2010, it's been the same auditor back to then and probably further back than that. And so the auditor had some concerns, and for the first time, the auditor said that this district going forward would not be a low-risk auditee. And that's a major little wake-up call, because if you are not a low-risk auditee, that means they don't have to dig as deep into your business. But what they're saying that San Benito, they've got to dig into it a little deeper. They've got to assure themselves that everything is kosher. They got to do more testing, and it costs a little bit more, right? If they could just come in and just look through a couple reports, or it's not that easy, but just do a cursory review and just do their work plan, that would work out better for the district. So they've given the district notice of that, and that I suspect. As your own superintendent's fund balance analysis up there, you're running pretty good on the fund balance, about $18 million a year, kind of whatever you took in, you spent, and you still had $18 million, and all of a sudden, boom, you got $8 million. So what happened to the other 10? Well, you can read your audit, and you can glean of what happened to it. Somewhere it was spent, or it's going to be spent, because it maybe is sitting on the books as a liability, and it will be paid back in a future time, but it's already claimed against the fund. So the district has basically four funds. You have your general fund at about $100 million of expenditures and revenues. You've got your food service fund. I believe it's running around $7 million. You have your debt service fund. Expenditures are $8 or $9 million a year, and then you have your federal funds, your Title I, Title II, III, IV B, Title VII, and etc. So what we will do is we will look at those funds, largely the ones that the district has some control over, the revenues and expenditures, and that is the general fund, the debt service fund, and the food service fund. Now, the federal funds are an application. You apply for those, and you put in the grant what you propose to do with the money, and then the auditor audits to make sure you spent the money just like you said you were going to do. So literally, when you approve the application for that audit, for that Title I plan or whatever it is, you are encumbered then to only spend that money as you said you would. Now, you can make applications to change that, but that will not be our focus. He or she audited those areas, and I believe had no comments. Everything was going good. What you said you were going to do to spend the money, that's how you spend it. Now, it'll be up to the administration in some future time to determine, you know, how efficiently you spent that money. Did you spend it on the right things? But the auditor doesn't measure those, and neither will I. All right? The first thing that I want to do is to look at the 13-14 audit. I've already been provided a copy of the 13-14 audit, and the significance of that is I want to have a clear understanding, and I will meet your chief business officer tomorrow, and the information will be provided to me, I'm certain, what I ask for. I have a clear indication how we got to $8 million, because you started at 18, and then you received about $96 million of revenue, and you spent about $93 million of revenue, and then something happened down here, and you ended up with eight. And I want to be, and I told the superintendent that there will be a listing. This is where the money went, okay? There's no fraud involved in any of this. No one stole any money. He's already determined that it was spent in legal manner, right? But that doesn't mean that that's how you wanted it, or if you hindsight that you'd want to spend that away. So just let's determine, because I suspect, and somebody can correct me if I'm wrong, you did not find out about this $10 million shortage until after the year started and possibly late in the year. So these audits come out in January, the board approves them. But your year started around September 1, or physically started September 1, and you might have started school a little bit earlier, August 28th or 27th or whatever. But your year's already, 5 months over? September, October, November, December, January? Oh, my gosh. So my question then is going to, my task will be, second task, is to look at the 14-15 and try to estimate, all right, we started with 8 million. Are we going to end with 8 million, or are we going to lose some more? Or are we going to gain some? I don't know. But we will be able to predict with some accuracy where he should be at the end of the year. And I will tell you that I'm not going to make that prediction, as I will work with your staff. Your staff knows this budget. They know every account in there, and et cetera. And they will prepare an estimate of the revenues and expenditures for this year. Now, I've already seen work of that tonight when there's a budget amendment. Well, most districts of any size will do a budget amendment every month, because a budget is just an estimate of the revenue, and it's an estimate of the expenditure. And the longer you do this, and when you have a stable population like this community does, to make the estimate on the revenue is not that difficult. You just have to count children and put them in the template, and you get so many dollars per student, and then it differentiates by whether it's a gifted and talented student or special ed student or a student on free and reduced lunch, or if it's on the CTE, in the CTE program, there's different weights on there, and you get paid on that weighted average daily number. So your staff will be able to provide that, and after 5 months, you can make a better estimate than you could last July before the year started. Now the year is, we're at the downhill and it's almost over with. So we will want to be able to do that. If we have opportunities and staff identify opportunities to spend money in a different manner or not at all, then we'll bring that forward. But that will be up to you, right? So then we can get through this year and make our estimate for the August 31st, 2015. Because you will quickly start working on the 16-17 budget. Now, I don't know what the history of this district is, but many districts of this size start hiring good teachers come February, March, April. You're not going to pass up a chemistry or physics or a math teacher comes in and whatever starting in September. You're not going to wait to August to hire your teachers. Right? You may pass the budget in August for next year, but you're actually going to start committing yourself to expenditures way before then, right? So that's why it is somewhat incumbent upon staff to, you know, keep up the budget amendments and hope, and I have not seen one yet, and hopefully that budget amendment gives some idea. It doesn't say, you know, we're, as an example, if it says we're increasing revenue $1 million. No, it ought to say we're going from $93 million to $94 million. Now, that is a budget amendment. And what effect does that do to fund balance? Because if it's just a pure raising revenue million, then your fund balance ought to go up $1 million. But if you're raising it $1 million on the revenues and you're raising it $1 million on the expenditures, there's no effect to fund balance. Right? So those type of things. So I guess that would have to be my presentation. And if there's any other questions, or any questions at all, I'd be happy to attempt to answer them.
Mr. Strong, I'm going to ask you about, thank you. One of the issues we've had has been with the health insurance plan, clearly. And you've seen a lot of districts. You've been in small, medium, large districts. Can you talk to a little bit about the self-funded plan locally and how many districts are doing what we're doing right now? Okay.
When I started out in the business, many school districts had self-funded insurance because the state did not start their TRS active care program. I think it was in the 90s. In the early 90s, they started that. Now, and there are 1,029 school districts. My latest information says there are 970 school districts that are on active care with TRS. These school districts have figured out that they're not experts in managing large health insurance companies, because that's what you're doing when you self-fund, right? You're the directors. He's probably signing the check. Somebody's signing the check to pay the third-party administrators. You don't have time to actually check on all the claims and do all that kind of stuff, so you hire a third-party administrator to do that, and you hire an actuarial consultant, and you should have a financial advisor. And those people kind of work together, and they run your plan. The problem is that you don't have enough people. You only have 2,000 employees. And that may sound like a lot, and it is a lot, but when you're looking at health insurance, you have what's called adverse selectivity, and that is the sick people are definitely going to sign up for your insurance. The well people will not. They may do something else. And then if it doesn't take much, say the whole group, looking at the groups, take adverse selectivity out of it, you just may have an older, sicker group. Well, it's going to cost you more because you can't spread it out because you don't have enough young people that, you know, that you still pay the $330 a month for, or $360, whatever it is, but they don't get sick. And that's how the insurance programs work. It's the well people kind of moderate the cost for the older people, and it doesn't have to be old, but the sick ones. Let's put it like that. And then that old and sick, my personal experience, it kind of goes together. we may recommend looking at that. You want to probably do that anyway. You don't need somebody like me come down here and say, look at it. You can look at it. Yeah. I mean, and it's good. It's run by the state, and like I say, there's 970 school districts in it, large and small, biggest to the smallest.
I'm going to ask you about the tax swap that was done here in 2010. You know, you were a CFO in Austin, you were a CFO in Dallas Eyes. You've seen all of the different types of tax swaps these districts do. You've seen it. In 2010, it was done here, where the portion of the INS was moved into the M&O, and of course that generates a little more funds. Can you talk about what that means and any legality around that, and why it's done? Theoretically.
Okay. Tax swap, and I'm familiar that your INS tax rate was 26.29 cents, if I'm right, and your M&O was 1.04, and the M&O on the 1.04 can go up to a maximum of $1.17 across the state. And so the administration elected to recommend to the trustees, and the trustees approved, have an election whereby you transfer 13 cents of the INS tax, take it down 13 cents, and add 13 cents to the $1.04, bringing it to $1.17, and your total tax rate didn't change. It was still $1.45 or something, $1.55, whatever that is. The total didn't change, so it made an easy sell, and it does. I mean, tax swaps, I think there's been about 200 of them, maybe 250. Many school districts have had an election just to raise their M&O and not swap, so that when the total elections is something like 350 across the state. So you do a tax swap, and you do it because it makes you money. In your district, a penny generates somewhere around $80,000 per student. No, $80,000 per penny on the tax rate. So instead of using 13 cents, let me do something a little bit earlier, easier, and use, in my example, 10 cents. So on the debt service side, that 10 cents will raise you $800,000. 10 times 80 is $800,000, right? Now, 10 cents on M&O also raises $800,000. However, on the INS side, that $800,000, that's all it raises. There's no anything that goes with that. However, you do need to say that you receive some what's called instructional facilities allotment and existing debt allotment based on tax effort. You could have never have paid for your $38 million bond issue around 2010 if it hadn't been for this. All right, so they're gonna, and that's about $5 million that they pay on top of this 800 in this example. But the 5 million is a real number too. So when you put it over here, you get the same 800,000, but then you get some guaranteed yield money. And that's, I'm gonna say, $6 million. It's a little bit more than this over here combined, because, and the idea is that you're losing this IFA and EDA money, but you're getting it over here under a different auspice. So you make a transfer from the general fund over. Huh? Doesn't matter to you. And then what's left is the gain. And the gain should be, I'm going to say, $1 million. That'd be realistic. You don't have a $5 million gain. You got $1 million gain. But you got to make sure you don't spend that money, because it's in the general fund, and everybody looks at the general fund, and then they start hiring more people, and da-da-da-da, and all of a sudden, you don't have the money to transfer over. Does that make sense? Because you've spent it, or maybe you only have $2 or $3 million or whatever. So that's kind of the simple part of it. Another piece of complexity, though, and you ask, and I'm telling you, there's a thing called unequalized tax collections. Now, when you did the swap, you had in a balance sheet in Austin some unequalized tax collections. So for a couple of years, you got your $1.5 million over here, right? And plus you got that $800,000. That $800,000 went down, but you had enough. So you just had to switch over just a little bit, and you had a big gain. But I don't know exactly what year, but I'm going to say somewhere around 2012, 13, maybe 11, we'll find out tomorrow exactly what year, you ran out of unequalized tax collections. Ooh, now you got to really be sharp. And hopefully you did not take that money and spend it on reoccurring cost. Because if you spend it on building roofs, buying buses, fixing the parking lot, buying furniture, those one-time costs, right? Next year, the money's there. You got another choice what to do next year. But when you started hiring those people, they just stayed on the payroll. And that, I suspect, that now there's not enough money over here to pass over here. That's what I suspect. Now, in a couple of years, you had some fund balance in your INS fund. Didn't have much, if I remember, but there was a couple million in there. So you took that out of there. So fund balance in the INS is zero, and this is approaching zero. So one of the things that we're going to do is on this estimate for the current year, 14-15, how much are you going to use out of the fund balance over here, or the extra revenues? 96 and 94 leaves you two. If you don't spend your 96, is the revenue, and you spend 92, you get $4 million. So it may never get to fund balance, but it'll be current year's revenue move over plus some fund balance. And then what about the year after that, which would be the one we're kind of building towards, 15, 16? How many years can you go moving that money over? Now, you could be okay if you cut your expenditures and freed up those funds. And that's really what we're looking for. Do we have to cut expenditures in order to have enough funds to bring that over? Does that make sense? Yeah, that's what there's no calamity out there. The school district's not going to go broke, and they're going to pay all their bills, but they've got to figure out, and we're here to help you. But your staff, we're not going to identify anybody, any certain person you need to cut. You know, we'll say, hey, you need to cut payroll by this amount. And before you look at payroll, well, look at purchase and contracted services. Can you do anything there? What about supplies, 6,300? Can you do anything there? I don't know, you know, but somebody in this district does, or they can find out. So that's kind of where the 8 million it may not be the bottom. That's what I'm kind of tell you. So we'll do the best we can. And you have very capable staff. You know, they've been here a good while. They know this thing inside and out. And the good thing, too, is all school districts in Texas have the same accounting system. So when I go in and ask for a 199 function 11 63990001, and then whatever the program code I throw out on there, that's a supply at a high school in the general fund. How much you got in it? What's the budget? You know, and then how much you spend in instruction, function 11. Everybody's coding the same. So one of the things that we'll do too is compare, when we do the staffing, is we'll compare expenditures by function with the four peer groups, so that are like you in size and those things that I mentioned earlier. That makes sense. Okay. Thank you very much for the opportunity.
We look forward to the report. Thank you. Okay, move to item number, where are we? Seven. A closed meeting discussion under the authority of Texas Government Code 551071 for the purpose of private consultation with the board's attorney on any subject or matters authorized by law. A, discussion and possible approval of settlement agreement regarding 2013 DCL 6486H, Health to You versus School District 551074 for the purpose of appointment, employment, evaluation, reassignment, duties, discipline, or dismissal of a public officer or employee, to hear complaints or charges against a public officer or employee. A, report on personnel. B, employment, resignation, and retirements. C, discussion and possible approval of D, Noyola separation agreement. We go into executive session at 8:35. Session at 8:47. I'll ask for a motion to approve as recommended on items A, separation agreement, and also on C, the approval of the A, the agreement on regarding health to you versus the school district, and C, discussion on the separation of Dean Oyola. There's a motion on the floor by Anna, the second by Ms. Fatima Huerta. All those in favor, stay by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those against?
I abstain.
You abstain? All in favor, one abstention. Next item on the agenda is item to adjourn. We are adjourned. 8:48.